Now our discussion on Libyan Jewry in World War II, the presentation of Harvey Goldberg and Yossi Sukari. For Samir will close the workshop with some concluding remarks. However, the last session of our workshop is not the last event of today, because let me invite you to the guest lecture of our ERC project, which will be held by Professor Sheldon Garros, who was here before. And he will speak to us on the transnational destruction of cities, what Japan learned from the bombing of Britain and Germany in World War II. And the lecture will be at 4:30 in the Senate Hall, but after refreshing, I think we will go all together from here. Or who wants to join? So, now coming back to the workshop, so I'm delighted to introduce to you our next speaker, Professor Harvey Goldberg. Harvey Goldberg is a professor emeritus, actually from here, from Hebrew University in Jerusalem, where he has taught and researched at the Department of Sociology and Anthropology. But he was also a visiting professor in Istanbul, Paris, Berkeley and Pennsylvania. In his work, he has sought to combine anthropology and Jewish studies, and he has, among other books, authored Cave Dwellers and Tribal Growers, Jewish Life in Muslim Libya, and he added a volume on Sephardi and Middle Eastern Jews. From his latest publications, I just want to mention his article, The Notion of Libyan Jewry and its Cultural Historical Complexity. His talk today will discuss open questions and varying perspectives on the anti-Jewish riots in Tripoli in 1945. So,
thank you very much, and also thanking everybody here for everything that I've learned in the past day and a half. I decided to shift the actual presentation to sort of complement what is in the written material that I sent you. The written material I sent you is, as it was in fact published a number of years ago, dealing with a massive anti-Jewish riot in Tripoli, which was in November 1945. It clearly erupted in the wake of all the disruptions of the war, but it wasn't, it could not be connected directly to the Holocaust or fascism as we see it, but it certainly is a case where I think the title of Judging Histories is appropriate. So that text is available to you, but I thought after hearing so much about the French Margaret that I talk about Libya more broadly, touching some points of similarity, of differences, to help carry the conversation forward with this kind of, you know, thinking of models, factors, and some kind of comparative perspective. And I apologize for some very basic things that I may be saying about Libya and Agra, but I think that it's worth at least touching the base momentarily. When we say about the Maghreb, with regard to Libya, that's not totally correct, because in fact, the eastern part of Libya, Cyrenaica, is the western end of the Maghreb. And I mention this because I don't think we should forget the vast distance between these areas and the desert that separates them, which is related to the fact that Libya is quite a modern concept. There were, in Ottoman times, you could see attempts to bring the country together and unify it. I think officially the Italians made it a unified sort of colonial structure only in 1934. But certainly the term Libyan Jewry is a bit of is certainly very, very modern. Libyan nationalism per se, I think one could easily say, developed after the state of Libya was created, early in 1952. There certainly was nationalism before that, but it didn't. It cannot easily be linked to the notion of Libya as it came to be, including Tripolitania, Cyrenaica, and the Fezzan, particularly with leadership coming out of Cyrenaica. And when the Libyan state was created, formally created at that time, most of the Jews had left. Most of the approximately 36,000 Jews had left. Just to fill in basic data, before that exodus, about 22,000 Jews lived in the city of Tripoli, about 8,000 in the hinterland, there are small towns around Tripolitania, and about 6,000 Cyrenaica, with approximately 4,000 of those in Benghazi. Now, as we said, we've heard the territory of Libya is vast, but from these figures you can tell that the Libyan Jewry was by far the smallest of the Maghrebian Jewries. I think it less than half of the number of Jews in Tunisia, and that fraction becomes lower if you compare it with Algeria and Morocco, of course. Now, from this brief description, let's take a step back to some of the colonial development. Of course, in the late 19th century, the Italian imperial and potentially colonial presence was felt. But the country did not come under Italian rule until the war, the Turkish-Italian war in 1911. And it was mentioned early in the morning. In fact, that was only a temporary advance during World War I. The Italian hold basically retreated to the coastland, and the country was reconquered. After World War I, with basically Tripolitanian coming under control around 1920, Cyrenaica, the resistance of the tribal groups in Cyrenaica continued to around to the early 1930s. So the whole period of total colonial control was quite short. In January 1943 is when the British, the 8th Army, completed the conquest of Tripoli and essentially all of Libya. Now, of course, in this period of time, fascism and the figure of Mussolini is very central. There are some complex parts of the story that are worth keeping in mind. The strong racial laws that were passed in 1938. The alliance with Hitler and so forth were not part of the picture in the early 1920s, and these things evolved gradually. And I'll just mention a couple of points which I think illustrate the complexity of the story. Now, Mussolini, in his colonial goals, which were not only in Libya, he was apparently looking around the world for lands where he and Italy could stay out of play. Apparently, one image that he had in his mind were Jews, particularly Mediterranean Jews, as possible source of support for his program, for sympathy, for backing, and so forth. And there's one indication of that, which is, curious, very related to our being here. Mussolini, when the time the Hebrew University opened, provided funds to develop Italian studies and a library in Italian. I happened to learn about this was in relation to my late colleague Claudio Segre, who I mentioned before, who passed away, alas, at the young age of 58, and his widow was interested in contributing his library to the library here. A very open library, so I'm not so happy to get books if it's sort of an extra burden. But I learned at the time that from the very beginning, there had been a good collection of Italian literature and history and so forth, and they were happy to accept this gift. So that's just sort of one indication of how, at the time, Mussolini envisioned a possible source of support from this direction. Another not too well-known story, although it's written up very nicely in an article in a meme, I can again throw out a plug to translate the Articles of Rebellion into English. It's a story of a rabbinical ceremony, a seminary, that is not a traditional East European yeshiva, but a modernizing rabbinical seminary that was established by the Italian in Rhodes in the late 19th. It was open from about, I don't remember my dates, 1929, maybe as late as 37, 38, maybe. Rome remembers somehow. But in doing this, Mussolini filled a lacuna that was pretty much overlooked by the Allianz, who were providing education schools for the Jews throughout the Mediterranean world and beyond. Pretty much stressed the Jews learning the three R's, as we'd say, learning French language, culture, learning skills, and left the topic of Judaism aside. At times there were discussions within the Allianz that maybe we should be providing a sort of a more updated version of Judaism, but this is something the Allianz never did. And here we find Mussolini offering this opportunity. It was never a very famous, influential institution, but again, it indicates that Mussolini had this idea. Of course, the big picture was that in this effort, Mussolini obviously learned that if he has to choose between support of the wider Arab Muslim world, the support of the Jews obviously becomes secondary, tertiary. But I think it's important to know this. The second part of this story, this I know mostly from having talked to many Jews from Libya in here, Jews from small villages, Jews from the city of Tripoli, and so forth, is that there was not a great deal of consciousness of the Italians and of the fascist ideology as something which was threatening for them. They knew the story of the last years and so forth, but they mostly saw, and those who still remember, continued to see the fascist, the Italian era as an area which was beneficial to them. Now this may partially relate to what we heard in the previous session, the very tough stand, one can say, I have no hesitation, say brutal and cruel stand, that the Italians took towards the local Arab resistance, Muslim resistance, dissidents, and so forth, which provided a sense of stability, control, and so forth. That the Jews felt that they were that they were living a life they weren't privileged except the fact that they felt safe and protected, and they no longer had the formal status of dindis, although clearly in everyday life there were many ways in which the Jews, particularly in the small towns, made sure that they acted according to the traditional etiquette of recognizing the superior status or the accepted status of the Muslims in everyday life. But in the city of Tripoli, there were Jews who had become middle class merchants and so forth, who felt pretty sort of comfortable in everyday life. With regard to the villages, there are interesting stories. There was the whole project of agricultural colonization that the Italians undertook, reaching into the tens of thousands, and very often the places that were chosen for the settlement were close to the towns and the countryside where the Jews were concentrated, and so the Jews got to at times had the opportunity of going to the new Italian schools. Very often these rural Jews ended up going to school for 2 or 3 years, something like that, learning some basic Italian and so forth. But I came across instances, for example, where they had learned the national anthem or the fascist anthem, I don't know exactly the details. So they were part of the scene with no sense at all that this is something that somehow or other was threatening to the Jews in the long term. And certainly this was true with one organization that emerged among the Jews of Libya, the middle class. There were two kind of Zionist-oriented organizations, one by the name of Ben Yehuda, which was more for people from the traditional Jewish part of town, I think it was called Mahara, and was more oriented towards studying Hebrew and so forth. There was another one, the Maccabi organization, which was linked to the world Maccabi, and which was sort of more middle class, social club and so forth. And the head of that organization until very, very late in the 1930s and then ended up being very, very close to I ended up already mentioning some of the complex figure of people of Balbo, and how, among other things, it was clear that he tried to deflect the, and he succeeded for one, deflect the application of the racial laws. And I don't say this to attribute any wonderful motives to it. I simply tell it as a fact. This was the strategy. Put it this way, the strategy was not totally informed by a view that we harm the Jews, whatever may happen. Now, the World War II harmed the Jews in a variety of ways, and some of them have been mentioned, and they were different. They were labeled labor camps, forced labor camps in Tripolitania. Some of the bombardment, the very heavy bombardment of the city, which really disrupted Jewish life, was about the bombardment by the Allied planes coming in trying to take out the anti-aircraft batteries on the coast, which were right smack close to the Jewish quarter. So the Jewish quarter became sort of a minor hell as a place to live during this period of time. And many Jews sort of just escaped to the countryside, very often taking up residence, you know, with Arab Muslim families who took them in, and there was a kind of a modus vivendi. The Jews were there, you know, commercial, you know, buying and selling everyday matters, were able to get stuff through the black market for these Arab families, and that it was obviously seen as a kind of coexistence. And of course, it was a story of essentially the vengeance of Mussolini in a very direct way on the Jews of Benghazi. I assume we'll hear more about that in the next talk, which resulted in this exodus to Jaja. Another side, at least from some descriptions of the Jaja camp, is that apparently Jaja was about 150 miles south of Tripoli. About half that distance was an area called the Varyan, where there's a Jewish community. And there were at least some reports of the Jews of Varyan providing food, sending food to help people in Jaja. Obviously, they weren't able to, free to do this all the time, but Susan mentioned things like this happening, or somebody has it happening in Morocco, Jewish communities trying to help people in camps. So there are a lot of sort of undescribed episodes that is worth trying to get information on if it said, well, if it's all possible. Incidentally, when again, I don't really have all the details at my fingertips. One of the people who tell the story of Giotto, the British, after they conquered Tripoli, didn't clean up the Giotto mess so quickly. Things dragged on there for a while before people released it in the camp and so forth. So that there are there are many stories. Most of them are gray rather than black and white, and there's a lot more to study.
Thank you very much for sharing your insights on the situation of the living jury. So the floor is open for questions and remarks.
I have a question.
Harvey, you're a consummate ethnographer. You've done ethnography on communities that are gone. What's your sense about, is this now historical material? How can we make use of all the great work you did on Libyan Jews?
How can we
make use of this? Those of us who are historians. There are testimonies that are difficult to triangulate. As a historian, I ask myself, how can I make use of this material in ways that will support, if I'm interested in working on Libya, support a historical narrative?
Personally, some of my own material I placed in as a kind of an archive. There's now the center. This was set up in 2000, but it developed slowly over time. There's a center, a heritage center of Libyan Jewry, which is to a large extent a museum, but there's also kind of a research room which is devoted to research, and a man who heads that up by the name of Yaakov Hajjaj Nibu. For example, that in that center you can find many, many pamphlets of what we call a vanity press, people who have taken their own personal stories and written them down, some of them in Italian, some of them in Hebrew, and so forth. Many of these things don't make their ways into the National Library, the public libraries, but they're, and many of them copy from one another, but partially copy from one another. But there's a lot of material there. Some of my recordings and notes on various topics that there are, I've actually tried to file in other ways. And there, Yaakov is also in. Still knows, he's at the center of a network of people who are alive and still tell these stories. There are people, there's one man in particular who very often at events shows up, a man who was actually interred in Bergen-Belsen among those Jews who were taken from Benghazi and ended up on that route. So there's still this material around, which is much more accessible, and it still can be found through the help of that center in ways that couldn't be brought before. I'm getting a little bit to aside. One of, to me, the very attractive and interesting sides of this center is that I think it began to form after efforts for many years where people talked about it and nothing happened. Precisely at the time where the older generation was dying off, people who were either born here, grew up here, there were documents, there were clothing, there was this. They didn't want to throw them out. They didn't know what to do with it. And all of a sudden, the center appears. So it's a great deal of enthusiasm. It's it's a kind of a museum that very much grew from the bottom up. Obviously, there had to be funding, and our present Ministry of the Treasury, Kachlon, comes from that community. A number of years ago, I think he was instrumental in getting actually a law passed, which partially supports this museum. So there is stuff around which hasn't been utilized, including little documents of home ownership or a lease, a sale, a rental, all sorts of stuff which really hasn't been used for research purpose, but they are preserved quite carefully.
Harvey, thank you so much. One of the fascinating things about your work is that I feel basically very lucky to have read your work, and it influenced a lot of what I've done as far as Southern Morocco. But when you think about oral history, and I'm sure you used a lot of that when you did your research on Libyan jewelry, one of the things that struck me in many of the interviews that I did, especially with the older generation of Moroccan Muslims in Southern Morocco, is the fact that many of them thought that because they were far away from the urban centers, because of the tribal makeup of the region, even though the French colonial authorities, which arrived to that part of Morocco in the late 1930s, early 1930s, I don't know about Libya, probably has its own historical dimensions, but at least the fact that they were away from the urban centers, it allowed them to be not as much affected by some of these racial laws, even though, for instance, in the case of the French in Southern Morocco, they had to employ the kulfa practices. So you Jews and Muslims have actually to work in clearing the roads and basically fixing roads. So that's something that affected both Muslims and Jews. And I've seen vignettes and stories in your work that it's also somehow it was very similar in many parts of Libya. So can we argue that if you extend this argument to the rest of North Africa, we could argue that that's something that we can apply to Algeria, we can apply to Morocco, we can apply to Tunisia, and we can apply to Libya in this sense.
Yeah, I mean, I would think that each country has its own particular geographic configuration, and the date that which roads were built and so forth has a the community that I originally studied, and I just mentioned that the Gregarian of Arian is south of Tripoli. In pre-motorized dates, it's two and a half days march across the desert and up a steep mountain to get there. Once roads were built, it's a couple of hours to get there. And there's an interesting dynamic to my mind of sort of distance and closer. Even the most distant places constantly had communication. The communication wasn't as rapid as we're used to today, or even like earliest 20th. But people knew about the world. They didn't know a lot about the world out there, but they were conscious that it was a world out there, and that the world out there was critical. I think I don't remember where I read this, but I think we could even apply this to Tripoli as a whole, sort of an image of the city of Tripoli being an island. Half of what surrounds it is water, and the other half of what surrounds it is desert. Mm-hmm. But you can't understand this place without understanding what comes in and what goes out, the constant connection. And even the people of the Gargan, who had a form of housing, when They have been known for a long time as the cave dwellers, the Jewish cave dwellers of Tripoli. Now, I was doing my first field research in 1964, and during that year, I'm sorry that I don't remember, but the Pope of that time visited, it was the first visit of a Pope to Israel, and he landed in Haifa and drove down, we used to call the inner road on his way to Jerusalem, which was not far from the village. Now, so this was obviously in the news and the papers on the radio, and all of a sudden I found these villages who met many Israelis, so as the epitome of being remote, and that's the way I started out, by gradually learning that image was overstated. They started talking about the Papa. There was obviously a concept that they were familiar with from having grown up in a kind of regime. Not that they had any deep insight into Catholicism or this or that, but you can see that the constant flow of information, contact, and so forth. And there were always a few individuals with a little broader view of the world, a little more contact, a little maybe more successful merchants, and so forth. But even those who were more local in their activities clearly knew that the issue of contact was of information of, as Levi Strauss would say, goods and words and even women was essential to the what was going on.
Thank you, Herbie. But one of the things which I thought we might kind of raise this discussion here about, you know, Libya is often sort of the exceptional case. I think you sort of correctly started out by saying, well, you know, Cyrenaica is not really part of the Maghreb, across the, you know, the rice to the couscous line of division or something. So, but also, you know, we've sort of heard in the discussion, Patrick's presentation, some ways with, you know, Libya's exceptional. I mean, it was also being such a battlefield during the Second World War. But I was thinking also, its exceptionality also is in the post-war period. You know, the rest of the Maghreb had still had we think about decolonization, you know, beginning at the end of the war, but of course, there was still some years before that happened. Of course, Libya was transformed for force of circumstance into a independent nation state before anywhere else in the Maghreb, and it was, of course, had the least kind of infrastructure of a nation state. So I'm wondering in terms of how that reflection, and you could say even an earlier departure of Jews from Libya might have shaped the way in which Libyan Jews, of which they probably only started to call themselves as such later on, may have actually shaped their memory of the warriors itself. How they related to what you've written about the riots in 1945, for instance. I mean, just for point of comparison, take the issue of the Farhud in memory in Iraq as a sort of comparative context, very different circumstance and the way it plays out in memory. So I'm wondering if in your either memoirs you're familiar with or your own research, if that sort of exceptional, somewhat different historical post-war trajectory it might be reflected
either the oral accounts or...
No, I definitely think that the sequence of events that followed, let's say, World War II itself, have a constant effect on the positioning that and the salience of these different events. Let's say the racial laws did have a certain effect on a certain amount of people. Soon, less than 3 years after the war, there's this tremendous pogrom. I think one could use that term, even though it comes from a very different context. And just to give you an idea, about 130 odd Jews were killed in the course of 3 days in Tripolitania. One Muslim was killed. And if you think of the overall population of Libya, take the percentage wise, it would be as if you had, let's say, a country of 10 million people, as if 44,000 people were killed all of a sudden. So it was massive. So people, had to process that. So I assume in some sense that puts what happened in World War II, which, except for the very dramatic Jada experience, was not super catastrophic, at least the way I've heard people. And then, then there were kind of other riots in 1948, which were less in their effect and so forth, which I think were more directly tied into what was happening in Palestine and Israel and so forth. So sort of one event then the Aliyah, which is on the one hand really. To me, the argument is convincing that the 45 riots set the stage for the mass of Aliyah. Not that nobody knew in 1945 that there was going to be a state of Israel. It's going to be a UN resolution on November 29th and so forth. But the degree of uncertainty that those riots led, I think set the stage ready with some kind of solution and the idea of an independent Libya, which nobody had any idea what such a country would take shape. So you have the Aliyah itself, and with about 4,000 Jews remaining in Libya and so forth. Sort of one sort of historical dislocation or historical rupture through these years after another. Now, one of the things that to me is curious about the center that I mentioned, the Heritage Center, they also are constantly organizing events, symposiums, and so forth, but they, one might say there's partially a ritual calendar which has emerged around the center. And every year, and there's a certain, within the museum, there's a certain row, which is a certain room, which is devoted to. There's a model of the Jado camp, which was first made by a man named Moshe Megiddish, who comes to lives in Moshav called Eli Shama. So it recalls this phase. It recalls the riots of 1948, and it also recalls the. There were already some Jews from Libya who got here in the sort of pre-state period. Some of them married Palestinian Jewish soldiers and snuck back into Palestine. But there were people. There were Libyan Jews who fell during Israel's War of Independence. So these three events are sort of merged together. I think taken alone, none of them might have the power and attraction to hold on to the memory and be important. So certainly of these three events, I think the one which most strongly enters into what has developed as a dominant Israeli narrative is the link to the Holocaust. You could say what happened during the Holocaust years in Libya was, let's say, a minor catastrophe, if you want to go with it. But I think that has been amplified because of its fitting the Israeli narrative, and much less on the memory of these very terrible riots in 1948. For example, another expression, there are many Libyan synagogues, and there's one of them in Ramakan, which is particularly active in putting out a calendar each year, a Hebrew calendar, Jewish calendar, marking certain important days. And it marks the days of certain sainted Libyan rabbis and so forth. It never entered the anniversary of this terrible riot. Which I know that there's some people who thought that Libyan Jews should be commemorating this every year, but it never happened in an institutional ways, as far as I know. So the content and the structure of the memory keeps evolving all the time.
Can I just follow up, Mike? So maybe to put it a little bit differently. Yeah, thank you for your response. But I guess what I was thinking, and maybe I'm trying to somehow bridge conceptually how to think about this, between sort of the memory or the ethnography of memory and the historical. When people left Libya, and I'll put that in quotes, there wasn't. Libyan Jewry didn't exist. It wasn't, neither conceptually or institutionally, it really didn't exist, right? There were different communities. I imagine that the events in Tripoli may have had some repercussions elsewhere, but what I'm saying is it wasn't necessarily their event, which that's why I brought up, in comparison with, say, Iraq, there was a sense of, at least among many, a sense of being Iraqi among Jews, right? And so at some point, with the examples you gave, these events, right, during the war, Gadol and Tripoli, they all became sort of symbolic of a collective memory that didn't exist earlier, and certainly not as Libyan Jews. So I'm trying to sort of get a handle about how we, about thinking about Libya in this larger context of what we're working on.
Well, I think it partially emerged. It wasn't created overnight. There are pictures of Jews from Libya at the Maccabiah Games in 1935, and they're carrying a flag which says Libya in Italian and Hebrew. Now, there's a very famous picture, to anybody who knows the history of Jews of Libya, when permission was finally granted that Jews could live. This was in April 1949. It was linked to a visit to Tripoli from what was then Israel by a minister who was very important in the politics of the Maftal, the National Religious Party of the Maftal. Mizrahi Paul Mizrahi Yitzhak Rafael, and there's a photograph of his standing on the balcony, sort of addressing a crowd of thousands of people, and by this time people from the villages had come in. They were no longer in their villages. They were crowded into the Jewish quarter of Tripoli, and each village is holding a poster. There's a village from Ambrus and Homs and Sleep in it. So you have at the same time this sort of connection to the very specific locality in the process of it being gathered together, and already in 1960 the sort of a committee linked to the Paul Mizrahi Party, Ma'ad Kilot Lu, committee of Libyan, the Committee of Libyan Communities and so forth, puts out a kind of memo book, spearheaded by a man called Fisher Suarez, who became a member of the parliament, called Sefer Yahdutu, already this is, and who's been obviously Serenite and then Gaza. So it's a process, but there is this shift, but it's something that is you can see emerging over time.
So we have one question from Sophie, and then we turn to.
Well, mine was actually about the exceptional case of Libya. So you already answered it.
Okay.
Great. So thank you very much.
So now I feel honored to introduce to you Zakari, who came to us today to present us his latest and most remarkable novel, Benghazi, Bergen-Belsen. Mr. Zakari lives in Tel Aviv, where he's teaching, also in Tel Aviv and in Jerusalem, but he's to the broader public mostly known as the author of numerous novels, I guess five, which appeared first in Hebrew, Miklator and Emilia, Umelach Aretz, and some of them even appeared in French, and as I understood now, also in German, will appear very soon in German translation. And he is the winner of some very remarkable prizes, most remarkable in the Brenner Prize 2014, and the prize of the Israeli Prime Minister. And he's also like a political activist on Sephardic identity in Israel. And Benghazi Bergen-Belsen is actually, as far as I understood, the first literary account released with the Libyan Jewry during the Holocaust. So we're very happy that you are here and to share with us the story and the history.
Okay, thank you very much. I'd love to be here. First, I want to say that while I'm speaking about this subject, from time to time can get excited, so please forgive me about it. And because of the simple fact that I haven't so many chances to speak in English, so if I have grammatical mistakes, so forgive me a bit. But I assume that my English is quite good. In 2002, I published a very well-known book in Israel. The name of the book is in Hebrew is Emilia v'Melach Haaretz. In English, it's Emilia and Salt of the Earth. In German, supposed to be published in German, it's the name Emilia on Zaz der Erde. And in French, it's Emilia Osef de la Terre en Confession. And it is a changing book in the Israeli literature atmosphere. It was a book about the relationship between me and my grandmother. She was from Libya, she was from Benghazi. My mother, she was from Benghazi. And it was a very extremely feminist book. And present in a quite different way than the Sephardic women presented in the Hebrew literature. They usually presented like a person who loved. They are a black woman, of course, and they're presented like a woman that only can cook and be in the kitchen and very warm and make children. And this book was totally the opposite. My grandmother was antithesis to this kind of description. She was very, very intelligent, extremely intelligent, with a tendency to analytical and abstract thinking. And she knew many languages, and she was not so conformist, to say the least. And she didn't accept the Ashkenazic hegemony in Israel, and the hegemony of the men in Israel. And she was not Zionist. So, and on top of all of these things, she was a Holocaust survivor. And half of the family vernished in the German crime. And my cousin of my mother, as well, killed by the German in Bergen-Belsen, taken from Libya. And in this book that I published in 2002, there is one short sentence that mentioned the fact that my grandmother was in the Holocaust. When she said to me, as a grandmother, she asked me to leave Israel because she don't want me to live in a state that occupied other countries. And she asked me not to live, not in Israel, either in Germany. Leave any place in the world, not in Israel, not in Germany. As you see, I'm living in Israel. And she asked me another thing, please bury me in Benghazi. And it's very difficult for a grandson to, because she chose me. Like, she chose me. I'm sorry to say, I don't want to sound arrogant, but when I was young, she chose me because she thought that I'm extremely intelligent and she loved me, and she put burden on my shoulders on one end, but on the other end, she sees something that will make her life full of significance finally after all this suffering. And but there is one sentence that I mentioned, that she was in the Holocaust. And some people, when I say some people, I don't mention the people that believe that are ignorance. I mean people that see themselves as the highest intelligence segment of the Israel society, and they tell me, wow, the people of Jews was in the Holocaust? You sure? You don't know that. How come? It's not true. And they ask me again, you sure about it? They were sad, they were dazed, confused, amazed, and shocked that it was not in the history books so much, not in the Israeli, in the collective awareness of the Israel society. And I decided those times to write a book, Benghazi Dagenbeth. I published two books since then, and then I, 4 years ago, I said to myself, now is the time to write the book Benghazi Bergen-Belsen about what happened to my family in the Holocaust. And my family was in Benghazi. They would belong to the upper class of the Jewish of Benghazi. They had the British passport. That's why they're taken by the Nazis. They didn't put them in Jado or in Geryan, the one that Harvey mentioned, or the other. There is another place, Seder Lazim, another concentration camp. They took my family to, because of the fact that they were British passport, to Tripoli, and then from Tripoli to Civitella del Tronto in Italy, and then from Italy to Benghazi, Bergen-Belsen, to die there. All this trip, all this journey took place, it was a grosso modo 3 years. You can ask a rational thing, why the Germans don't kill them in Libya, the desert? Why they have to take them to Bergen-Belsen? All this logistic thing and administration, things like that. And but the Germans were very rational, as you know, and accurate. And there is a reason for that. Because they, in some certain point during the war, Second World War, they want to make a change of prisoners. Check the prisoners of the prisoners that the British hold, all the German soldiers, and they because of my father, my grandmother, my grandfather, the British passports, and all this group, that the amount of the people that were approximately 1,000 Jews that took to Bergen-Belsen. All of them, as I just mentioned, as the British passport, they want to change them with the prisoners. But step by step, gradually, langsam, they gave up this, and they realized that they cannot do it, and they took all my family to Berlin. But you have to imagine now a thing. A family that belonged to the bourgeois, a family that belonged to the upper class in Libya, live. I can tell you with no hesitation that my grandmother had a great life in me. Great life. No conflict, no majority confrontations with the Arabs. I don't have tendency to make a idealization, but they had a great life. Very good relationship with the Arabs. They live in the desert. They live free there. And now the Germans take them to Europe from 45 degrees in a very chilly day. To live, to be in a place that the, I would say the average atmosphere there is like minus 10 Celsius in the winter. And you can understand what is the shock that they experienced. While I wrote the book, before I wrote the book, I made a profound and deep research. And unfortunately, my mother collapsed twice throughout the research. And other people that I spoke with many, many living Jews that don't many, but at least dozens, that some of them were in the Holocaust and took to Bergen-Belsen. And imagine that the heroine of my book, Silvana Hajaj, that she was based on my grandmother's story. She was 24 years old, extremely beautiful, lived freely in the desert, 45 degrees, don't know what is German, never heard Yiddish in her life, never heard German in her life, taken to a Europe. She don't know what is Europe. She's the first time she saw snow. And one of the most sensational things, and the people related to sensational, but the few facts that make a lot of noise. This book make a lot of noise in Israel. And now it translated to English, and I'm going to, I just won another prize by that financed my book to English, and now they finished the translation, and now we are looking for a publisher in America. I hope that we find. And one of the things in this book that it describes the relation, the people that cannot, it was something that you cannot touch it, like a holy, there is expression, holy cow?
Holy cow?
No.
Sacred cow.
Sacred. Sorry. I don't know. I'm sorry for that.
No,
holy cow.
Okay. Sorry for that. Okay. But you must agree that relatively to the fact that I don't have any chance to speak English, my English is quite well. Okay. So what I'm saying is, one thing that makes a lot of noise here in Israel, okay. What happened after this book that now everybody knows about the Holocaust in Libya? Historical books written from many, like Yaakov Hajaj Lilov, that is a great person and great, he wrote an history. But sometimes, if you write a good literature book, it discourages the history to speak. So it's because otherwise, sometimes what can literature can do is history books or historian books cannot do. So it's encouraging to speak, that's what I meant. And that's what happened, and I'm very, very pleased with this fact. And as I just want to say again the point that make people very, very, I don't know, uncomfortable here in the public sphere, I would say, in Israel, was the description of in this book, in the last chapter of the book, which is called Bergen-Belsen, that described the relationships, not between Bergen-Belsen, between the prisoners from North Africa and the prisoners from Europe. The Jewish from North Africa and the Jewish from Europe. And there is, in those kind of relations, I describe it after I asked my mother. I remember my grandmother speaks because she always told me stories. I heard about some of my family and some other people. The white Jewish from Europe, the Ashkenazi, some of them, not all of them, but some of them, without any hesitation, I can say these kind of things. Didn't relate so nicely to the black people that came from Africa. They were Jewish, white, European, totally European, speak German, speak Yiddish. You have to understand the Bergen-Belsen, most of the people from Bergen-Belsen were from Netherlands. Yeah. And then they suddenly see Jewish, that they are black, speaks Arabic, Italian maybe, don't know German, don't know Yiddish. They felt much more close to the people from Germany, to the Christian from Germany or from Netherlands or from other countries, than the Jewish from Africa. There were Africans from there. And it was part, on contrary, what you know, I don't know if all of you know, who is Kate Zetnik, Kuf Zetnik, you know? Is that his name? Kuf Zetnik, you know? Okay, there is one a person that wrote, I would say, like a very, I don't say substantial or significant, but important known books about the Holocaust. His name is Kuf Zetnik, and he made an expression that everybody speaks while they speaks, about the Holocaust. They say, other planets. The Holocaust is other planets. Like, we cannot understand it, we cannot describe it, we cannot realize it. It's other planet. But I'm not agree with Kuf Zetnik. I think that what happened in the Holocaust was, of course, it was a radical situation, extremely radical situation, but what happened in daily life between people happened in the concentration camps. Like, if you patronize one on another, it was a concentration camp. If the, it was everything was there. It was racism in the concentration camp. It was it was even sex in the concentration camp. Everything was there. And when people say another planet, they have a misconception. And as I told you, she was a woman. She came from North Africa and came to a place that totally different from all variety and diversity of aspects. And she became a leader. And that's why this book is feminist as well. What we have to understand that in the Arab community, the Arab Jewish community, and I criticize it from time to time, they're the pattern of patriarchal families. And now, throughout this journey, that they go from the desert, from Benghazi, Juliana. Juliana was the best bay of North Africa, the most beautiful bay in North Africa. It was in Benghazi. They live in the bay. She was a 23 years young woman that lived in the bay, and taken by the Nazis with families and fathers that only used to patriarchal way, and all the men, the respected men and rich men, because who was the men, the family that taken to as I told you, the family that taken to concentration to Bergen-Belsen were very relatively were rich, and the men collapsed after. One after another, they collapse because of the journey, because they cannot understand, they cannot adjust to the new environment, to the new circumstances. And then she is the one that takes the leadership. My grandmother, Silvana Khajaj, is the name in the book. The name, the real name is Emilia Salah. She became the leader, and she tried to manage, she started to manage all these things for 3.5 years. And couple years ago, I found in Google something amazing. You can look in Google. They found in the BBC shelters that not long ago, tape cassettes of the rabbi and a broadcaster English from the BBC and British rabbi that recorded, both of them recorded, the people that they released in Bergen-Belsen in 45, and when they released the people sing the tikva. Mm. They sing the tikva. It is in the, you can see it in Google now. If you want, you can hear it. And this is the way my book is end up. But one thing I want to mention, from the research that I made before I started writing the book. And it's very significant and substantial evidence. And it indicates about the lack of consciousness of what happened to the Libyan Jews in the Holocaust. And you know that the Holocaust is almost a religious in Israel, but they don't know this very important fact. So, one thing that I mentioned, in 1950, in the 50s, Ben-Gurion, that was the first prime minister, the legendary and first prime minister of Israel, asked Nahum Goldman, you know who is Nahum Goldman? He was the president of the of the Jewish society. So he asked Nahum Goldman to negotiate with Adenauer, that was, of course, the Chancellor of Germany after the war, because he asked him to negotiate with Adenauer about the compensation that the people that survived the Holocaust were supposed to get. And it was in Israel, in the public sphere in Israel, a great debate about it. Menachem Begin said, we don't want to touch in blood money, German money. And the Begin said, what do you care if it's blood? We need the money to make a reconstruction in Israel. What do you care about it? Begin said, we starve, but we're not taken. So Begin told him, you are not in the government. I decided, I'm going to decide. He asked Nahum Goldman to make the negotiation with others. The Jewish community were very young. The Libyan Jewish community were very, very young. After it was a couple of years after the war, like 10 years after the war. And they come to Nahum Goldman and say to them, we were in the Holocaust as well, not only the Ashkenazi, not only the European Jews, even the black Jews were in the Holocaust. So they say to them, we want to be part of this compensation agreement. Nahum Goldman said to them, the only place that you saw a German was in your head, it's Eastern imagination, and you'll never be part of it. So that's what I want to say. Thank you very much. I can answer every question that you want to ask. Thank you.
Very, very much for the moment insightful. So we're running out of time, but we should collect some questions, I guess, to them.
Yes.
Can you tell us something about Libyan Jews now? Are they making a bid for compensation? Is there an effort to
listen? You know, in Israel there is such a method that you can get what you have to get. For instance, it's a sad story. What you just mentioned a very sad point. There is now one of our members of the government. His name is Moshe Kachlon. You know, is Moshe
Kachlon.
I was one of the 300 ministers. I was his consultant about this point, and some of the people get now the compensation and the money. It depends, well, if they were in Jado, so they get less. My mother, for instance, because of the rebellion and everything, she gets substantial amount of money every, like, 1,500 euros and 500 euros every month. But most of them get like a couple of hundred of euros. And it took time, a long, long time, that the people recognized that the Libyan Jews were the Holocaust as well. And I can tell you that my mother get the money just after I act in a violent way in the governmental places in Israel. And that's the only reason that they gave my money, my mother money, only recently, relatively to the fact that she had to get it 50 years ago. And there is, as I told you, a couple of, now they get more and more and more, but of course, it's not like the other people get the compensation. Yes.
Yossi, thank you very much. I'm really honored to hear you, and not just for your book, but for your activism in large concerning Mizrahi Jews or Arab Jews. And in this, my question is, I just hear those sensitivities that we lack in academic research, that we are depersonalized, de-emotionalized in the way we have to write. And you brought it in a very, I don't know, it was kind of summarizing almost everything that we are doing here, and it's really great. But I wonder, because you came to write this book as an activist, because you were bothered by the inner Israeli power relations, and So can you say something about the connection between the way you study this history and the way you position yourself within, and it's important for us because I think that what we are doing here is much more than acquiring more information about history. So
okay, thank you very much for the question. First of all, I want to say to you that first of all, I'm an author, I'm a writer, I'm intellectual, a writer, a author, not this, not the other thing. And I love literature in from the bottom of my heart. And of course, I think that there is, in my point of view, we have some intellectual professors and authors and writers that hold a view that we belong on one end to the left, but on the other end we see ourselves as sort of sporadic, and of course there are people that not agree with us and other people don't, but this is our group. And we think that the Jewish from Morocco, Tunisia, Algeria, Turkey, all these places depressed by the Ashkenazi hegemony, that's what we think and we believe, and we are not afraid of anybody. And we say it, in every, I'm writing an article in Haaretz, I wrote at least 20 articles, but some of them about these issues. And we are not afraid, not of everyone. And we think that it was a distorted situation by the fact, for instance, I'll just give you the numbers now. The people that came from North African countries in Israel, there are 50% of the Jewish society in Israel. Never, until now, prime minister from North African country. Only Ashkenazi prime ministers were. Never, even not one. The Supreme Court of Israel, which is the most important, is maybe one of the most important institutes in Israel. Never, only one judge is from North African Jews or Sephardic places. All of them, most of them, consistently, traditionally, they are from Ashkenazi diaspora. And not Arabs as well, unfortunately. That's why we see ourselves much more close to the Arabs than to the Ashkenazi. And I'm not afraid to say it. Culturally, of course, culturally, we are Arab, what we are. We are not European, we are Arab, what we are. We are Jewish that came from Arab countries. And of course, in religious point of view, we are Jewish and we belong to the Jewish, to the Jewish religions, but not from cultural point of view. And in the historical books, that for instance, my daughter, her mother came from Russia, and she studies 25, maybe 30 pages, among 400 pages that she studies in books, it's about the North African Jews. 30 or 40 pages, it was 9, now it's 30, out of 400. And you can study in schools, time after time after time after time after time about what happened in Kishinev pogrom. That, you know how many people died there? Only 49. But don't learn anything about the Turkish people, Jewish, the Russian, the Moroccan Jewish people, the Algerian Jewish people, the Persian Jewish people, the Libyan Jewish people, the Egyptian. They don't have history. They don't have past. The past is empty. You only study about the people that came from Europe. How can we feel part of this country? We don't want to be only the folklore of the country. We want to be one that, we have a representative that manage this country. And unfortunately, until now, 2015, we are second tenant in this Zionism Jewish establishment. And that's what we, but we try to fight to change the things. And it's difficult because we have a lot of enemies. People like to have the hegemonies, and they don't like when you say that you are black, they don't like the fact, and that Israel is full of racism. There is racism for against the Sephardic people, of course against the Arab, the most racist thing. It's awful thing in my point of view, and I'm not afraid to say it in any place, and I have a confrontation with people and debate. But if you are black, any variation of black, they don't like you, and Israel became a very, very, very racist country. I hope that you are okay with it.
That's really to the choir.
One last question, because we're running out of time, really, but yeah. One last question from Omar, and then we are like...
Yeah, thank you so much for your presentation, and I'm really looking forward to the translation.
So maybe if you find me a publisher in America.
I'm really looking forward to the translation of the book in English. I have a question about, so you talk a lot about Libya. Have you gone back to Libya? If not, are you planning to go back?
And I cannot, you know, now.
And, but
I forbid it.
But there is now, after the Arab Spring. After the Arab Spring.
No, but now Libya is very, very, it's a catastrophe place. It's full of chaos. What do you mean? First of all, I was born in Israel.
But how can you go with an Israeli citizen?
No, but just because there are,
Israeli passports. One direction.
There are few Jews who went back to Libya after the Arab Spring, and they even planned to do the conservation of the synagogue.
I was not born in Libya.
That's
Yossi, I want to tell you something.
Yes.
If you don't mind. We have in this room a group of professors of Jewish history. Some of us are Americans, some of us are not. We are teaching the history of your people.
I appreciate it very much.
In America.
I appreciate it.
And we have large classrooms of students.
60 students.
Who are learning this.
I appreciate it.
That are not Sephardic, mainly Ashkenazi. And also not Jewish. And we're doing our best.
Thank you very
to
much.
Correct this absence.
Thank you very much.
That we feel very strong.
I feel very thankful for that.
But I don't think it's known very well in Israel.
It's not.
That Kuzlavas, there are people who are taking this problem very seriously and doing what they can to present a revisionist history of the Jewish people.
You know Schusterman Foundation?
Yes, we know the Schusterman Foundation.
Because they just gave me a prize now. They want to say that they want to make a correction of this kind of thing in America.
They won't make a correction. We will.
Okay.
And those like...
No, maybe they give you money. Maybe they give you money.
They might help with that.
They might help with that. But the next generation of historians of the Jewish people in America are going to be different. Because you can't be a historian of the Jewish people today. Someone who's there, the rest of you can chime in. You can't be a historian of the Jewish people today in America without being aware of this situation and this problem and doing what you can to correct it.
I'm very happy what you said now.
This workshop actually is actually is a way to correct what you have been describing now. Well, I'm not going to change the word, but we'll try to write
marginal correction.
So this actually is
modest
straight to our
marginal.
It was actually a perfect closure of our session. Actually, thank you very much, Howie and Yossi. I'm sure that who hasn't read your books will do it very soon. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now it's up to Samir, the organizer of this wonderful workshop.
Okay, so I'll try to be very brief and I want to read what I have been writing. So, okay, so 2 minutes. Yeah,
okay, so maybe we'll make a break of 2 minutes.
Once you let them go, they're going to be gone. Did you know that, right?
No, but just one or two.
Peter, just bring up and go to the so maybe we're really running out of time, so we have to continue in like 1 minute. Otherwise,
Well, can only get I'm not sure.
אולי אופר, אתה יודע איפה החוט? צריך חוט שהוא נתן לוויליאם? אני לא יודע. אולי זה פה?
William.
State to state, nation to nation. The same perceptions and moral judgments can be deeply influenced by the historical implication of the nation as a group and the citizens as individuals in the event of the Holocaust, an event that marks the European collective memory and continental history in a different way than it did outside of Europe, for example, in North Africa and the MENA in general. At the end of this workshop, I would like to remind all of us again that the aim of this workshop is to explore the way or the ways the global events of World War II, with the genocide of the European Jews by the Nazis at its core, was historically perceived and morally judged by the peoples of and in North Africa, Muslims and Jews and Europeans, be they the French settlers, the Pied Noir, or the Italians, Spanish and Portuguese who lived there, or the European refugees from Western and Eastern Europe who took refuge in North Africa, especially in Morocco, running away from Europe on their way to exile in North Africa and in North America and South America. Here, I also would like to remind all of us that historical perception, or by historical perception, we mean the ability of the people who were there in North Africa at the time to understand the events of World War II in intellectual and scholastic terms in the long delay. Whereas by moral judgment, we are alluding to the following: how did the three North African antagonists, in one word, like judging history, Muslims, Jews, and Europeans, understand, speak, write, remember, memorize, feel about the same events in local, singular, cognitive, emotional, and Manichaean terms? That was one question. After these two intensive working days, we have seen that the intellectual historical understanding and the moral judgment of the events by local Muslims and Jewish North Africans, including the European of and in North Africa, were not necessarily in concordance with each other, within North Africa itself, and of course not with the continental, universal, and global way of understanding and judging the same event, which means it was like different judging and different understanding. North African Jews understood World War II in one way, the Muslims in another way, and the North African Europeans, the Europeans who live, or North African Europeans, I mean the settlers, and the Europeans, refugees, I suppose, had their own understanding of the event, which I suppose was continental. But in history, you never take anything for granted, which means we have also to check if their Moroccan episode, in which they turned into refugees,
have their own, have their way of perceiving and judging things, how the encounter, with the refugees alter the local world of vision, the locals who got in contact with them, which means how they alter the encounter between the Orphan Jews and the local Jews, alter their way of perceiving and understanding World War II. That's what I want to say. So, you would agree with me if I say that we have one war and several understandings of this very war. Therefore, our task is, and will be in the chapter that we will have to write, to find an epistemological way to allow a possible understanding of these different understandings. That is, how to bring them together, how to bring them to work together, how to neutralize the competition that exists between them, if not hostility, to achieve a sort of an epistemological bridge. We have to study the nature of the gap that exists between the protagonists, antagonists in and of North Africa at the time. The papers that have been presented in the workshop have shown indeed how the epistemological gap functioned, how it was constructed historically, discursively, practically, emotionally, and sometimes politically. The papers have shown how the epistemological obstacle between the continental and North African world vision is made of several epistemological obstacles. I wouldn't get into details, but you know, you have a rupture, and the rupture is made of different obstacles that we can fix, but we need time to contribute to a possible removing of this obstacle. First, we have to be aware of them. Second, to examine how and why they were constructed and by who. One of our aims concerning the narratives and discourses that we are constructing here is to achieve sort of balance, equilibrium, or even pacification in the competition of narratives, discourses, and memories about our suffering and their suffering, our corpse and their corpse, our debt and their debt. How we can do that? Through one singular plural prism of universal humanity, in this case, intellectual perception and emotional perception, moral judgment if you want, will be the two sides of the same coin. The way the two issues are connected to each other could be didactically and dialectically explained in the way singular memory is embedded in the historical plural memory, or mémoire historique pluriel, if you want, with which other cultures and experiences, especially beyond the Western parameter of knowledge, can identify with. In other words, can a straight line or even destroyed one be drawn vertically between the suffering of the French under the Nazi occupation and the suffering of North African Muslims and Jews under the French colonialism? What to do with this hierarchy of suffering among the Jews and between the Jews and others, which when I say others, I mean Muslims? On which basis can the qualitative or the qualitative symbolism of suffering be translated to a quantitative materialism of restitution, compensation, reparation? Whose suffering is countable and eligible? The European Jews or North African Jews who lived in colonial Algeria under Vichy regime? Or the Tunisian Jews who lived under the Nazis? Or the Italian Jews who lived under the fascists?
What about the Muslims who experienced French colonialism and the Vichy regime? Which hangmen are to blame in the North African colonial context? The Nazis, the fascists, or the French colonial collaboralist anti-Semitic regime? Whose pain can be measured? Who is to pay for the suffering generated by World War II in North Africa? The French colonial enterprise, or the Nazis, or the working camp on the Earth? What are the symbolical price and the materialistic price and the historical price to pay for all this? These are some questions that I've been writing while you were speaking about your papers. And then if we move, having said that, now, and keeping it in mind, I would go very quickly through the papers, but I'm not pretending to analyze your work, especially those who have been working on this subject for many years. But I would, if I go for some, the first chapter we hear by Daniel Schreuter with the construction of myth and fact, and we see how a myth can become a reality in special condition, how the people contribute to construct the myth to survive, and we see the monarchy used the myth of the Muhammad the fifth as the protector of the Jews, how the Spanish as well contribute in this construction of this myth, and how the Moroccans, I mean the people, trying to cope with this construction sometimes which came from above. And then we see that the project has another side, anthropological side, that Omar Boom is covering. And then you have two feet that your project is standing on, one historical and the other one anthropological. The way Omar Boom is working is an anthropologist way, but he's doing it from above. He's trying to see how the institution trying to construct this myth. And you wouldn't, I think, have a choice, but you have to go also to see how the people thinking about all this construction that comes from above, either from André Azoulay or from the palace or from Serge Bordeaux. The work of Suzanne Miller with the biography of Hélène Cazes Benatar, he's actually, this work actually is upset, bouleversé, how do you say?
Overturned,
you know, the parameter that we have a Jewish Moroccan who actually feels deeply French, but she is not French. When the Jews come into Morocco, she is trying to help them. When they leave, she is changing her jacket, but she is all the time there. She has a conflict of identities, but she is also coping with the historical situations. And we don't know how we can, once her biography is done, I don't know who is going to adopt her. We have to think about those who are going to adopt her, Moroccan feminist, European feminist, Jewish feminist, or she was, we don't know. So we have to think about those who are going to adopt her biography while writing her biography. And here we can actually think about the people who are going to read her and adopt her, and sometimes even if it comes on the expense of her biography, her life even, which means we can use our imagination sometimes to create new worlds. The work of Henri, you know, has to do with Frenchness, with the Persian, and what is fascinating about it and what suits our, let's say, our, I wouldn't say ideology, but mindset, if you want, or our aims, is this equilibrium between the Jews, the Persian of the Jews and Persian of the Muslims during the Vichy regime period, and how that actually change the limits and the border between the communities, and how the French use this or make use of this period to start to regularize or police the society and control it. The work of Alma Heckman, is also fascinating in the way that she's using new sources to go beyond the limits of the archive, because sometimes, I'm sorry to say, but sometimes, you know, we are using the same materials and then we find ourselves repeating ourselves, and then because the archives is done in a way that is organized in a way, so I'm not trying to be Foucault here, but you know, just to say that we have to read these materials to interpret them and to read them and read them, and to do that we have to bring another sources to compete them or to challenge them. David, my friend, he actually did exactly what I asked him to do. and then you know your reading of the papers that you've been reading before, but you never looked for what I have asked you to do, and you did a great job. And then now that you did very good job, we ask you to do another thing, that you have to see now how the Moroccans think about World War II, and you combine it with the Holocaust. We see actually that Moroccans were both obsessed with the idea of the Holocaust or with the massacre of the Jews. And if you move from Adam to L'Avenir illustrates, maybe you will find some parallels, maybe you will find some contradiction, and I think in the conversation they advise you to see other sources, and we may add another questions to answer during your scheming of this newspaper. But again, we have to find another theoretical framework, so we won't just read the paper, but we have to connect them to the context and other sources. And the problem of the sources, it comes also in the presentation of Haim Sadoun, what kind of source can be a kind of reservoir of the historical material, the Jewish sources, or the Muslim sources, the French sources, or which language, the Judeo-Arab, or Arabic, or Hebrew. So, you know, for us, for historians, we don't care actually about what language, what is the origin of the sources, because we can use all the sources possible, and it doesn't mean that when you are using Muslim sources, you are actually you are writing Muslim history, or in the opposite. You know, when you are using Jewish sources, it doesn't mean that you are writing Jewish history, which means that we can, of course, I think, and I'm almost sure that you can read the documents in Judeo-Arabic and squeeze them in a way to get information about the Muslim society and about the relation of the between the Jews and Muslims, and about Morocco from source that it was not actually designed in this way, which means we can actually force the literature and force the sources to work for us and not the opposite. So which means we can't stop ourselves from looking information about Muslims in Jewish sources and about Jewish information in Muslim sources, and the vice versa. If in the 1 minute that I have, I would maybe go very quickly, but Sophie Roberts' work is fascinating in a way that actually I find it's a little bit corresponding with Aurélie's work, and you know, it has a potential to serve the Jewish Muslim relation. I'm sorry if I'm forcing you, almost forcing you to work in this direction, because
I need it.
because we see how it's very very important. And Patrick Bernard, you know, there is one point that I found it fascinating, and UC confirms it, the issue of race. Where is Patrick?
Yeah, yeah.
The thing of race, the color, the colonialism during this period, it can be really a source for so many things to work with, especially when we heard the thing about the black Jews and white Jews, and there are so many things to do with blackness and whiteness. I forgot the word. You know what I mean? Okay, so, and now we can, Harvey, we have to see what you have been doing, and from there to see how we can go further what you have been doing on the Libyan Jews, because the pretext of there are no sources, it's not pretext for historians, so they can open their mind, we can use anthropology, the work of the anthropologists and their insight to go beyond the obstacle that I have been talking about them. And then the UC came and in a way he actually summarize all what we have been doing through his novel. Just to tell you again, this is not new. That a novel or literature can sometimes do what we cannot do. You know, we are actually limited. We go to the archive, and then the archive dictated for us what to do. Of course, sometimes we use our imagination, but not too much, because we have either supervisors or Susan Miller. don't imagine too much. But you have to. You are not a writer. You are a historian. But UC is doing actually achieving our fantasies as a would-be writer. Okay. Thank you very much for all of this. You know, there are so many, there is a whole list for the logistic things if you are speaking about the World War II. But I will summarize also the list in one word. Iris Nachum, where is she? She is the conductor of everything.
Can Leo